And Parfait is actually a pastor at her church. So, and in addition to all of that, she is the coordinator of the Friends Women's Association in Burundi. And there's a couple of pamphlets going around, but I'm just going to quickly just read something about the Friends Women's Association. Is a grassroots organization founded by and for Burundian women to address the unique needs of women in the conflict and post-conflict environment. This organization was founded in 2002 by a group of women who needed a safe place to discuss their HIV positive status. Out of these meetings came a desire to improve each other's lives and in particular address the interconnected challenges of poverty, HIV, AIDS, sexual violence, and post-genocide trauma in their communities. So that's the kind of work that they're addressing. The association runs the Kamenji Clinic, which we'll hear more about from Parfait, which runs the programs for those. And I'd just like to take a minute to acknowledge and give thanks for the life of Crystal Kleinman. Betty is some knew her because Crystal left us a legacy or a trust when she died and asked that we use it to support HIV work in Africa. And none of us quite knew how to make the connections or how to do that. And it sat for a few years. And then Celia decided we really needed to get on it. And she asked me to be involved. So between us, and with some help from Rachel Singleton Polster and a few other people, we were connected with the Friends Women's Association. And consequently have been able to offer financial support for this new program of caring for HIV positive people and develop what I hope will be a long lasting and mutually supportive relationship with Burundi, with Quakers in Burundi. So I really give thanks for Crystal and for entrusting us with her legacy, and I apologize that it took us some time to get going, but maybe it was the right time. Maybe 5 years ago we wouldn't have made these connections. So, and I just really like to thank Parfait for coming and spending part of this weekend with us while she's in Canada working on peace studies at Selkirk College.
Our Father in heaven, we thank you for this good opportunity. We thank you for the warm welcome. I thank you for this new family because the church around the world is one family. I thank you because the good plans you have for us, because I have never planned to be here, but I am here according to your will. I praise you. I praise you also for this opportunity when I'm going to speak. I want you, God, to continue to be with us as Quakers so that you can be the light of the world. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This is how Quaker evangelism.
Before you start, there's some of us who are hearing impaired, so if you could have a nice, clear, loud voice, that would be helpful.
Okay, thank you so much. I have already introduced myself. I am Natahuba Parfait. I'm coming from Burundi, and Burundi is a small country in East Africa, and I am... She already told you that I am married to one husband and I have six kids. I have three sons and three daughters. I am here from the end of August. I was here for peace studies at Selkirk College, and I'm enjoying being here because I am in my field, because I am committed to peace building. And I enjoy being here because the courses I'm taking from at Selkirk College are very helpful for me, so that they are inspiring me how we can improve our programs. So I'm very thankful to be here. I enjoy being here in Canada. Canada is a good country, a nice country. the only problem is the weather, it's too cold. But I enjoy being here. So I'm excited to meet all of you because you have been communicating through emails, especially with Janine and others, from you. To see you face to face is a chance for me, it is a chance for me. And that is why yesterday I was excited to do my best to be here. And the things that encouraged me is that one of our teachers, when we were doing peace studies, he told us that in our lives we have to be courageous. He told us never give up, be courageous so that you may be successful. So I enjoy being here. Maybe I can speak a little bit about my background. I grew up in a Catholic family, and in my family, there was a lot of violence. My father used to abuse my mother. Yeah, he often beat my mother. He was accusing my mother that she was not producing anything for the family because my father had a job while my mother was jobless. She had just worked in fields. And because she was not bringing some financial support to the family, my father was judging her that she was not producing for the family. However, my mother was working hard in the family because we were 9 kids, and she was very busy with the housework and working in the fields. But my father was not recognizing that my mother was doing something. And since my childhood, because my mother was living such kind of life, I felt that I had to struggle to work hard so that I can finish my studies, because I was believing that my mother was suffering because she was not able to finish her studies. And I'm thankful because I was able to finish high school and attend university and get a degree. So I am thankful because I was able to do it, because I was thinking that my mother was suffering because she was not able to finish her studies. And I'm thankful because I am now here because I was able to do my studies, and I am here because my husband is different from my father, because in our African context, to have a husband who can support you to go away for 4 months from the family, it is very rare in our context. And now he's very busy with 6 kids. So I say that this is the background, my background, the life I have, because when my father was maybe beating my mother, some our neighbors had to come and watch, some were laughing. And the following day, when I had to go to school as a child, I was very shy, thinking maybe people are laughing at me, maybe people are criticizing our family. And it was very hard for me because, since my childhood I was very shy, but it was because I was thinking that people are laughing at us. That is why in my pastoral work, I like to do premarital counseling for those who want to get married. I like also to teach married couples about communication, the family, how to manage the wealth of the family, conflict management. I like to teach it because for me, I don't want women who can suffer like my mother was suffering. Mm-hmm. I don't also want some husband to suffer, because I have learned if you, even though you are an offender, you can also be traumatized. And also I don't want kids who can grow in the violent families like me, because I was affected, I was very shy, I was traumatized inside myself because of the way my parents were behaving. Because my father he used to beat my mother, and my mother, because she was not able to beat my father, she just insulted my father. It was so wrong. somehow had, because I remember one day when my father cut the mouth of my mother, saying he wants to reduce the size of the mouth so that she can speak few words. It was very harmful and painful. So this is a little bit about my mama, my background, and that is why I am committed, I'm involved in fighting against gender-based violence, because our country in Burundi, our culture is favorable to gender-based violence. I want to speak about Friends Women's Association. It is a grassroots organization which started in 2002 by a group of women which were from the Evangelical Friends Church of Burundi. And it was after attending a workshop on trauma healing and HIV/AIDS, and they decided to start the Friends Women's Association. It was in a post-conflict period in our country, because there was a civil war since 1993 in our country. Because the problem was between the Tutsis and the Hutus, because we have two main ethnic groups in our country. And since our independence in 1962, Tutsis were the ones who were ruling the country. Tutsis are the minority, and the Hutus are the majority. And they were ruling the country from 1962 to 1993. And in 1993, it was the beginning of democracy in our country. And because the Hutus were very angry, they were against the Tutsis. When with the coming of democracy, Hutus went together and they elected a president who was a Hutu. Do you understand what I mean? And when they elected the president who was a Hutu, after 3 months, because most of the militaries were Tutsis, they killed the president after 3 months. And when the president was killed, Hutus were very angry and they organized themselves to go in the forest to fight. And they fought for more than 10 years, since 1993, because they came back in 2003, and Tutsis and Hutus were killing each other at that time, and it was even that time when my father was killed in 1993. He was killed, and even though he was an abuser and offender, we have suffered in our family because he was the one who was providing for the financial support. As kids, we were suffering, but I'm thankful because my mother was able to raise us, because we were able to finish our studies. My mother was brave because she was able to join some grassroots organizations to have some support for us. My father was killed at that time in 1993, and it was that time, because our father was killed and our house was burned, and we had to run away from our home. And it was my father was killed in November, on November 30, 1993, and we ran away. And when we ran away, we were received by a Quaker family. I told you that I was a Catholic, but when we went there in a Catholic, in the Quaker family, I started to experience a new life, because when we were there in that Quaker family, I have never seen the husband beating the wife. They were laughing, they were talking to each other, sharing food. In our family, I have never seen my mother and my father sharing food. My father had to eat alone, and then my mother had also to eat alone in separate places. And when I was there in the Quaker family, I was excited by such kind of life, with the relationship between the wife and the husband. And since that time, it was 1994, it was on Christmas Day that they invited me to join them in their local church. And since that day, I joined the Quaker church because I was thinking that this is the kind of life I like, to live peacefully without fighting in the house of violence. This is how I joined the Quaker family. And now I was thinking about how Friends Women's Association started. It was in the after the 10 years where Hutus and the Tutsis were fighting and killing each other. And when they were fighting, most of the men and boys were recruited to be soldiers, to go to fight, and most of them died. And when men were being killed, women and girls were being raped. That is why Friends Women's Association started at that time to address the problems, because we are working in a small community which is called the Kamenge in Bujumbura. Bujumbura is the capital city of Burundi. And there, we had a lot of widows and orphans, and most of the widows were also suffering from HIV/AIDS. And then the Friends Women's Association started there to help those people who were living with HIV/AIDS. Now we have five programs. With the five programs, we have one program which is called Rape Survival Support. We have another program which is called Improving Women Reproductive Health. We have a third program which is called the Link Up, and a fourth program which is called Action on Gender-Based Violence, and the fifth one is the Caring for HIV/AIDS. If I'm coming back to the first one, the Rape Survival Support, the purpose of the program is to help the rape survivors to reintegrate both socially and economically in the community. With that program, Rape Survival Support, we organize trauma healing workshops for rape survivors, and we conduct a three-day workshop on trauma healing. And because of through the workshop, we are able to speak about what is trauma, the causes of trauma, the symptoms, the consequences of trauma. People are able to share about their stories. And you know, if someone is able to share about what happened to him or to her, this is one step for trauma healing. And when we are doing those trauma healing workshops, people who have the same problems are put together and can share about what happened to them. And if someone is able to see that he is or she's not alone, she can feel that some people are experiencing the same problem, the same story. This is also a part for trauma healing. And through the trauma healing workshops, women can start to have self-esteem, because you know, rape in our culture is considered as a shame. People have been raped, they think that they are nothing. They are somehow marginalized in the community. And in our context, if for instance the husband can know that if the wife has been raped, the husband can leave the wife and maybe marry another one. So with the trauma healing workshops, it is helping those victims or survivors to be healed. And during those trauma healing workshops, we are able to speak about some taboos in our country. And after those trauma healing workshops, because you know that someone cannot heal after only 3 days, we have to organize home visits and to continue counseling. And then you organize them into income generating activities so that they can be independent economically. This is the first program, which is Rape Survival Support. The second program is about improving women reproductive health. The purpose is to contribute to birth control, because in our country, there is hatred, there is a lot of violence because it is a too small country, and we have an average of 1,000 babies born per day, and people are killing each other because of land. And there is also some conflict between the husband and the wife, because in our culture, most women, they like to have a lot of kids. I don't know. This is our culture. They like, that's maybe I have 6 kids. Women like to have a lot of kids, while husband, they don't like it, because most, in our culture, most of it is, most of the husband are the ones who have job. They have to provide financially for the family. And if the wife is making more kids, it is very dangerous. And then it can create conflicts between the two, the husband and the wife. And most of the time, the husband prefers to leave the first wife and to marry another one. Do you understand what is happening? Because even though the husband marries another wife or the second wife, and then he will also make more kids. And there will be a lot of conflicts between the two wives and hatred among the kids. That is why we are contributing to birth control, so that to see how we can sensitize both the husband and the wife, that birth control is both for the husband and the wife. And we are thankful because now people who are coming for birth control, since we started this program, the number of people are attending our clinic for birth control is increasing. A third program that we have is about what I call the Link Up. Link Up is, the purpose is to improve the sexual and reproductive health of young people. Because in our country, if for instance a young girl gets pregnant, she's maltreated by her family members. That is why with Link Up program, we encourage young people, if they are not able to abstinate. To do abstinence, I don't know if it is an English word.
Yeah.
We encourage them to use condoms so that they cannot, to protect them against HIV/AIDS and to protect them against unwanted pregnancies. Because if a young girl is pregnant, she's maltreated by the family, and most of the young girls, when they are maltreated by the family members, they have a tendency to run away from the family. And when they run away from the family, most of them, they go in the urban cities. When they go there, most of them become prostitutes. And you know, if prostitutes are very dangerous for the whole community. And if they don't become a prostitute, when they give birth to the baby, some girls they kill the babies just when they give the birth to the kid. They have to kill the baby and try to hide. And when they are identified, they are put in jail. That is why we are encouraging them, instead of having those unwanted pregnancies or to fight against HIV/AIDS, we are encouraging them instead to use condoms. Our fourth program is about action on gender-based violence, because I told you we have a program which is called Rape Survival Support. This is about gender-based violence case management. But now, because we have seen that through our beneficiaries and also as a pastor, when I'm listening to women, because you know, if you are in our churches, most of our church members are women. And when I'm listening to women, most women are suffering in their homes. They just stay there because maybe they don't have choice. That is why we have decided also to start to do an action on gender-based violence, starting with our churches, because we have seen that gender-based violence is also present in our church. Maybe it is in Burundi, not here, but we have seen that there is a lot of violence in our homes. Even church leaders can also be the actors of causing gender-based violence. Yeah, that is why we have now, we are working with the church leaders from the Evangelical French Church to fight against gender-based violence. We have to sensitize them so that they can be aware that gender-based violence is also present in our churches. Mm-hmm. We have decided to go there because we have some stories. We have the National Council for Churches in our country, they gathered us as church leaders to do an action on gender-based violence because there was a family, there was a wife whose two arms were cut by the husband. And the wife said that it is because she was giving birth to only girls. Because in our country, a girl, some people don't believe that a girl is a child because they believe she will get married and the family will disappear. This is what is happening. And you know, if someone has no arms, she cannot feed herself, she cannot nurse herself, she cannot go into the washroom alone. She needs a lot of help. That is why we have also decided to sensitize church leaders to make an action on gender-based violence, because even some church leaders, they are using the Bible, interpreting the Bible in the wrong way, where they say, women, you have to submit it to your husband. And they don't, this is true, but they don't remember that also the husband have also to love their wives. And we have to respect each other. This is why we have started this program to mobilize church leaders, because with rape survival support, we are doing case management only. Now we are doing that second program so that we can do a prevention against gender-based violence. We are also planning to start another program to where we'll be including young boys, another program which we are calling Engaging Men in Fighting Against Gender-Based Violence. But we are planning to work with young boys so that they can grow up with a non-violent spirit. Mm-hmm. Yeah, this is the fourth program, and the other one, the fifth one, is the one which is now being supported by Vancouver Island Mafia Meeting, and we are very thankful for the great support you have provided for us, because since July we have started that program. And you have heard that since the beginning of Friends Women's Association, our target group was HIV positive people. And it was in 2002, and it was not easy for us to do something which is maybe significant, because it was in 2013 where the Ministry of Public Health gave us a permission to help, to care for those HIV positive people. But it was not easy for us because we didn't have some medical equipment, especially the complete blood count machine. And now, because we are able to have the complete blood count machine, we are able to help those HIV positive people by giving them the retro drugs. Thank you so much. Yeah, this program is have the different dimensions where we have we have the medical care, we have the social psychological care because we do dialogue groups. It is a kind of trauma healing to listen to those HIV positive people. What is happening to them, so that they can maybe experience trauma healing. We will start those dialogue groups since March to 2016, and also we have with that program we will be also doing to organize them into self-help groups so that they can be independent economically. So we are very thankful because it is a program which is going to last for 3 years. It started in July, and it is supported by Vancouver Island Monthly Meeting. Yeah.